Baba says, children, your clan at this time of the cycle is the highest clan. You are now Brahmins and you are going to become deities. So Brahmins becoming deities, that is our clan, the highest family of God. God at this time has given us a new spiritual birth, or we can say that we have died alive. Do all of you also say that? Those who say that yes, we have died alive, raise your hand. Yes, okay. Well, they say on the path of bhakti or in the world, they say that you cannot go to heaven or you cannot meet God until you die. You know, whenever someone dies, they will either say that he's gone back to God, or they will say that he has left for heavenly abode. So when does one go to heaven, or when does one go to God? Only when he dies. So, in a way it is very true, because it is actually the memorial of Sangam Yuga. When we die a spiritual death, or we die alive, or we take a spiritual birth, because physically the birth, the body is the same. In a physical birth and death, a soul gets a new body and that is called birth, and when it leaves the body it is called death. But when we say spiritual birth, the body remains the same, but the soul is like rejuvenated because it is transformed, it has changed, the sanskars have changed. When one dies physically, the sanskars don't change. The soul takes the same sanskars of the past birth into the new life. But here the body is the same, but sanskars are totally changed. Because all of you can experience this, what you were before you came to Baba and what you are now, so different. Your thinking has changed, your vision has changed, your attitude has changed, hasn't it? Hasn't all that changed? Those who say yes, it has changed, raise your hand. Yes. So body is still the same, but spiritually we have changed, and therefore we say it's a spiritual birth, or we can say that we have died alive. When one dies in a physical way, the soul forgets the old birth, the past birth. Similarly, here Baba says you have to forget your past birth, your past life, though you are in the same body. But before you came to Baba, God knows what actions we all must have done. But that was on the path of ignorance. We did not know that whatever actions we were doing were not right. They were sinful actions. We didn't know that. Because Baba has given us the knowledge of karma philosophy, that any action committed under the influence of body consciousness becomes a sinful action. This is as simple to understand. People ask, how do I know whether I've committed a sin? But the criteria, the line Baba draws is that any action done under the influence of body consciousness goes into the category of a sinful action. And any action done under the influence of soul consciousness goes into the category of a righteous action. It's as simple as that. So we were all body conscious. We did not know what a soul was. We didn't even ever think that we were souls. But after we got this knowledge, we have now realized that we are souls, and we see each one as a soul, as a child of the Supreme Soul. So all of our whole lifestyle changes, actions, thoughts, words, feelings, attitude, vision, everything changes. So it's a spiritual birth. And as we die alive, we have a right to meet God. And therefore Baba says, do not invite newcomers to meet Baba because they will not recognize. On the path of bhakti, devotion, people don't know how they can meet God. Baba was saying yesterday that people really don't know how they will meet God, whether they will go to God or God will come to them. Because up to now we had been thinking that after doing a lot of bhakti, we can ultimately go and reach God or meet God. But Baba says totally contrary to this, that on the path of devotion we only fell, we only came down the ladder. There was no question of meeting God. We only came down the ladder, and when we reached the end of the ladder, the fag end of Kali Yuga, Iron Age, then God Himself has to descend to take us back home. So there was no question of going to God, but God has to descend to take us back home. And therefore we say that with that faith and courage and love and respect for God, that for the past 70 years God's task of world transformation is going on. And it's so interesting to see that within these 70 years, since from the time Shiv Baba came into this world in the body of Brahma Baba, there has been such a drastic change in the world. And we are seeing that how the deterioration is taking place faster and faster. Many people question us that if you say God has come 70 years ago, then why is the world deteriorating? It should improve, no? So the answer is very simple, that world will not improve in this way. Just like when a tree grows old, that tree will not become young. Like the body, as it ages, it won't become younger, it will definitely grow older and older. This body won't become younger. But yes, as the body gets older and older, it will die one day. It has to, this is part of nature. But then the soul is eternal. And that soul will get a new life, a new child, a new born, a new birth, a new body. So this body won't become young, but it's time for the new body to be given, to be got. Similarly, the world won't become better. The world will become worse and worse because it is, the cycle is spinning and it is reaching its fag end. But yes, Just like, you know, you have an old tree and you want to make a sapling from an old tree. How do we make saplings from old trees? We take one branch from the old tree and just put some, you know, mud or manure, whatever. You just put it, soil underneath at the bottom of that stem and tie it. And gradually what will happen? It will bear roots. That stem will start bearing roots wherever you put the soil. And you tie it up. And gradually the whole other tree will deteriorate, but that stem will become like a new stem because it will get a new life. And then you cut it off and plant again. So that old tree won't become young. That will be have to be destroyed. But it has given rise to a new sapling. And that new sapling will lead to a new tree. So similarly, Baba says, the world will not become better. But from the old world, Baba has selected his children who become the instruments for creating the new world. Through their transformation, through their change in their thinking, behavior, feeling, attitude, they then become the instruments for the new age. So this is what our task is. And we say it with pride that we meet God. We talk to God. God talks to us. God adorns us. He is purifying us. He is giving us instructions directly. And we hear God directly. Which may be very surprising to people. I don't know how many of you must have, before you left your countries to come to Madhuban, told your family, your friends, your relatives, because they must have asked you, where are you going? And you must have said, I'm going to India. And they would have wondered, why you're going to India? What is there in India? And you must have said, I don't know how many of you said, I'm going there to meet God. How many of you said that? Did you say really? Those who are raising their hand, did you really say to your friends and relatives and family members that I'm going to meet God? And what was the reaction? Gone crazy. Are you gone crazy? What is wrong with you? How can you say that? Because usually when somebody says that, it is very much understood that only after death one is able to meet God. Does it mean that he's going to die there? But we say, yes, we have died alive. And only then we are privileged to meet the Supreme. But how will God meet his children? We are in the physical form. And God is incorporeal. Though we are souls and we are children of the Supreme, but we are in the physical form and God is the incorporeal Father. So in order to meet his children, he needs a physical form, definitely. It's like, you know, supposing there's a child and the father is 6 feet tall. It's a very physical example. The father is 6 feet tall and the child may be just 2 feet tall. You know, he's just a child. Hardly 2 feet. And the father wants to pick him up or bring that child up to his level. Now how can the child reach the father on his own? Because he's so small and the father is so tall. So in order to bring the child to the level of the father, what does the father have to do? He has to bend down. He has to bend down. He bends down and then picks the child up and maybe put him on his shoulder, put him on his head, or maybe even fling him if he's a small baby, maybe fling him in the air and pick and catch him. And sometimes, you know, children sit on the father's shoulder and the father tells them, see child, you have become taller than me. And the child is so happy, oh, I'm taller than my father. But the father is happy because he sees that the child is happy. But it's not that the child really becomes taller than the father, but he's sitting on his father's shoulders. So we can understand that how God comes and awakens us. He rises us. He uplifts us. And sometimes he says, children, see, my worship is only in one form, but you children are worshipped in three forms. Because God is always incorporeal. We take a corporeal form too. So our incorporeal form is worship, our corporeal form is worship, and also the angelic form is worship. The gods and goddesses. You know, there are the two types of gods and goddesses. One are what you call as Lakshmi Narayan, but then the other are the Shaktis. They are worshipped in a different way. So they are the memorials of the confluence age, or the angels as they are shown in the West. So we can say that our incorporeal form, our corporeal form, and our angelic form. So all the three forms are worshipped, whereas God neither has a corporeal form nor an angelic form, only the incorporeal form. But yes, He descends in the body of Brahma Baba, in the corporeal world, and now in the angelic world, in the angelic body of Brahma Baba. So how Dadi Gulzar, she is an instrument who meets Bap Dada in the subtle regions, and then how Bap Dada descend in her body, and Bap, and they speak through her physical medium. So we say that Shiv Baba does not have his own physical form or angelic form, but he does take the medium. And Brahma Baba is the only medium. Gulzar Dadi will be not called a medium in that way. Yes, in a way, yes. But Brahma Baba is the only medium, because Shiv Baba will not work without Brahma Baba. So therefore we say Bap Dada, coming in the body of Gulzar Dadi. Dadi Gulzar just hands over her body, and Bap Dada does the rest, talking to the children, looking at the children, giving toli to the children, blessing the children, giving drishti to the children. And we say that at this confluence age, we have three rites. These three rites will continue till the end, till Bap Dada and the children are here, or till Sangam Yug lasts. The three, privileges, or the three rites we will keep on claiming till the end. And which are those three rites? One is drishti, the other is a blessing, and the third is toli. So drishti, blessing, and toli. These three we will continue to receive till the end. So blessing means which can be in the form of murli. Murli is also in the form of a blessing. The whole murli from the beginning till the end is like God's blessing to the children. The very first line, God has come, supposing the first line is, God has come to meet His children, the holy swans. So immediately we feel we have got the title, Holy Swan. I am a holy swan. So this is my blessing. And once I feel that this is my blessing, I am a holy swan, how do I accept this blessing? Not that I say, oh, Baba has called me a holy swan, therefore I am a holy swan. Of course I should be proud of this blessing, that God has called me a holy swan. But then, what is the duty of a holy swan? What is the responsibility of the holy swan? What are the actions of a holy swan? Are they my actions too? I would like to share my experience in this. I remember once I came in front of Bap Dada, and I brought a group. I had gone to Hyderabad, South India, and a big group from a big company, means I had served them and was with them, and they were ready to meet Bap Dada. So they came and I was with them. So Baba blessed that group, and then I thought Baba will just give me toli, that's all. And I just stood there taking drishti from Baba and with my hand like this to receive the toli. And as Baba gave me the toli, he held my palm, my hand, very firm. It was like, you know, Baba giving me this love by just holding my hand very firm. And I didn't expect anything else, because toli and drishti and a firm hand, what else do I want? The strength was coming to me. But then, as Baba held my hand with a loving drishti, Baba gave me such a beautiful blessing. Baba said, Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, is on your tongue. This was a blessing Baba gave me, Avyakt Bap Dada. Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, is on your tongue. That's all. And I was stunned. I didn't expect this blessing. And Baba, then after that, Baba, you know, took away his hand. But after that experience, that feeling, that blessing, my whole night I couldn't sleep. I just couldn't sleep. I said, Baba has given me such a big blessing. Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, on my tongue. What does Baba mean by that? Then people started teasing me, you know, those who heard on the microphone Baba spoke. People started, everybody, all of us, those who were sitting there, they began to tease me. Oh, Baba gave you the title Saraswati. So Saraswati in confluence age and Lakshmi in golden age. You are fixed. Your status is fixed for the golden age. You'll become Lakshmi in golden age. And they began to tease me, but I was just silent. I just was smiling, you know, silently. But whole night I couldn't sleep. I had so many, they were not waste thoughts. People could have waste thoughts. But the thoughts were, Baba has given me such a big responsibility. What does Baba want me to do? What does he expect from me? And if Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, is on my tongue, that means I have to speak only knowledge through these lips. My lips should not utter any other words besides Baba's knowledge. No ordinary words, no waste words, no negative words, just Baba's knowledge only should be spoken by me, because Saraswati is on my tongue. So whenever I would, you know, sometimes become very loose, maybe in my talk or anything ordinary, immediately I would remember, Baba has blessed me, the Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, is on your tongue. And immediately I used to become so attentive. But now this is the right way of experiencing the blessing. But some may say, oh, Baba has blessed me, Saraswati, so I am Saraswati. This is the wrong way. Then gradually it can turn into a curse. How? Because I am Saraswati, I am not paying any attention to my words, my verb, you know, my words coming from my lips, or not paying attention to my behavior. How can I be called Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge? But I have to pay attention. If I am not, and I am just proud of that blessing, it can turn into a curse. How? I'll tell you a story. The story goes, there's a story Baba talks in the Murli. There was a devil. He did lots of tapasya. And they say Shiva was supposed to be he's an innocent lord, no? Shiva, innocent lord. So, if anyone who does tapasya, does some penance, some, you know, intense efforts, Shiva is very pleased and he blesses him and tells him, okay, ask for any boon. So there was one devil, Hiranyakasha, Bhasmasur was his name. and he did lots of tapasya, and Shiva was pleased with him and said, okay, ask for any boon. He said, the boon I would like to ask is that on whosoever head I put my hand, that one should be burnt. On whosoever head I put my hand, that one should be just burnt, just turn into ashes. And well, Shiva told him, okay, ask for any boon. And he asked for this boon, and Shiva said, okay, it will happen so. Well, God can say, so he gave the boon, okay, it will happen that way. Tathastu, that is a Sanskrit word, it will happen that way. Now Bhasmasur thought, well, I can put this hand even on God, and I'll destroy God, I will become God. You know, that's the story. So, whomever he did not like, he would just put his hand above that person's head, and that one would be destroyed. So he felt more and more proud. Yes, now I can even conquer God. So he tried to go in front of Shiva and put his hand over his head so that he could destroy Shiva and that he himself could become God. Now Shiva, of course, he was Trikaldarshi, the knower of three aspects of time. So what did Shiva do? This is told in the scriptures. He sent Vishnu and told Vishnu, okay, you dress up like in a form of a beautiful woman. So she Vishnu dressed up in a form of a beautiful woman, and she came dancing in front of Bhasmasur, dancing. So immediately, he was a devil anyway. He didn't realize that this was God's way of destroying him. So she came dancing in front of him and told him, see, you repeat how I am dancing. So he was actually attracted to that beautiful, the dancing woman. And he started dancing in that way as she was dancing. And as she was dancing, she put her hand on her own head. And that devil forgot that on whosoever head he will put his hand, that one will be destroyed. He forgot that because he was attracted towards that woman, that beautiful woman. So what he did, with his own hand, he put his hand over his own head. Because he repeated the action which that dancing woman was doing. And as he put his hand over his own head, what must have happened? It was a boon which he got from God. But that boon turned into a curse and destroyed himself. You understand? These are stories in the scriptures. So God blessed him because of his little intense effort he did. But he took the wrong advantage of that blessing, and that turned into a curse, and he destroyed himself. So the word is Bhasmasur. Bhasam means ashes, and asur means devil. The devil who turned into ashes through his own curse, or through the blessing of God which became a curse for him, which he cursed himself. God didn't curse him. God had blessed him. So this is what we sometimes do to ourselves. Oh, I'm Baba's child. So Baba is my father. It's just like, you know, someone becomes, maybe he commits some sinful action, or maybe it's he does something wrong and he's caught, he steals or he kills, and maybe his father is a big judge in a court. And he may say, never mind, if I go in front of the judge as, what should you say? Huh? The one who commits, as a criminal. So if I go in front of the judge as a criminal, but that judge is my father, so he can save me, he can protect me. But will the father protect him? Because at that moment, the relationship is not the relationship of father and son. It's the relationship of the criminal and the judge. So the judge has to punish him, come what may. So we understand that God is our father. And at this time, Baba says, as a father, I'm giving you everything. But be careful, children. make the best use of it in a proper way. Otherwise it can turn into a curse also, which you will curse yourself. So 2 minutes silence. On the 31st of this month, all of us will be coming face to face to Bap Dada to claim our three rights: blessing, drishti and toli. So blessing will be of course through the murli, because of course during the earlier days Baba used to give blessings to every individual. But then now those days cannot come back, not at least in this kalpa, when Baba will give blessing to every child individually. Till the year 1989, Baba used to give blessings to individuals. Whole night Baba used to spend with the children giving drishti, blessing, toli to every individual who would come on the stage, and Baba would give him at least 3 minutes, at least. But now it's not possible with so many of Baba's children, so much of expansion taking place. But Baba says, you have to take the blessing from the murli itself. The very first sentence contains the blessing. Baba is looking at his holy swan children, supposing. It's a blessing to me. Am I like a holy swan? What does a holy swan do? It picks pearls and throws away the stones. So am I like that holy swan, picking up just pearls, that is the virtues of souls, and not looking at the weaknesses of anyone? If I'm doing that, then I'm like a real holy swan. So I have to check myself. Baba has blessed me that I'm a holy swan, so my behavior should be like that of a holy swan. I remember very interesting incident when Baba used to give individual blessings. One soul came in front of Baba, and it was very interesting that first of all Baba was inviting, and I was sitting next to Baba calling souls to come on the stage, and Baba would give blessing to each one. But there was one soul who was not willing to come on the stage. Maybe there was something in which was like making him feel guilty, and therefore he was afraid to come in front of Baba, because Baba's stage so high and his stage was not that high, so he was very afraid. Anyway, I told him, come, and he ultimately came. But when he sat in front of Baba, and Baba gave him drishti, but he didn't take drishti. He put his head down. And I was telling him, look at Baba, take drishti from Baba. He looked up again, he would look down, you know. He couldn't take the drishti, because Baba's drishti is so powerful. He just couldn't take it. He would put his head down anyway. But then Baba smiled, and Baba asked him a question. Do you consider yourself to be Master Almighty Authority? Baba asked him a question and he had to answer. He looked up and said, no. He said, no. Then Baba smiled at him and said, and asked him again, whose child are you? Whose child are you? He said, I'm Shiv Baba's child. Well, he knew he was Shiv Baba's child. I'm Shiv Baba's child. Then Baba asked him again, who is Shiv Baba? He said, he's my father. Is Shiv Baba Almighty Authority? He said, yes. So if Shiv Baba, your father, is almighty authority and you are his child, then aren't you also master almighty authority? Now he didn't answer. Then Baba said, yes, you are. No, he didn't say, yes, I am. So Baba had to tell him, yes, you are. Always consider yourself to be master almighty authority. Let anything come in your way at that moment, have this thought, I am master almighty authority. And that obstacle or any problem, anything, any situation will just go away. Have that powerful thought at that time. And let me tell you, that blessing which Baba gave him helped him so much that till today, you know, whenever he meets me, he says, sister, I can never forget that encounter with Baba Dada, how Baba blessed me. And I feel that after that, my life has become so easy. Anything happens, I remember Baba's blessing. You are master almighty authority. So this is the blessing which Baba has given to me, and I feel that I'm such a blessed soul. So, but at that time he was not ready to accept because he felt that he was weak. Now there are many children who think in this way. Now Baba says, you are master almighty authority, and I may say, oh, I'm not. Why don't you believe? God is telling you. If God is telling you and you don't believe, that means that blessing which you are receiving from God, you are just dropping it. You know, there are stories in the scriptures, in Indian mythology, there are stories that once God announced that God is going to give fortune to everyone. Come with your pots and pans and take the fortune from God. So everybody, some brought big pots, big pans, big utensils, but someone brought even a sieve. You know what a sieve is? Which has holes. Sieve for filtering tea or anything, you know, we have sieves. So he brought a sieve, and that sieve had big, big holes. And naturally what happened when God gave him that blessing, the fortune, it all drained away. Because he had brought a container which was not the right type of container. So Baba blesses us and we are not ready to accept. I may say, oh, I'm not like that. Baba says, you are my pure children. I may say, oh, I'm not so pure. So in this way, my intellect becomes like a sieve and I'm not able to take in that blessing which God has given to me. Because I don't accept myself as that. So if God tells me, naturally, I should accept it. It is a great honor for me. It is my great fortune that God has blessed me as that. And whenever any impure thought comes in your mind, at that time you'll remember, God has blessed me that I am a pure child of God. How can this impure thought come in me? Not the other way around. Oh, I have so many impure thoughts. How can I be a pure child of God? You know, that's not the way. I'm a pure child of God. How can an impure thought come in my mind and intellect? It cannot come. So this is the powerful thought, and that will, drive away that impure thought or that waste thought, whatever which comes in the mind. So this is the way of taking in the blessing. So I am Baba's blessed child, and all of you are the most fortunate ones. Baba says that though you have come late to God, you know, Baba, those who came 70 years ago, they must have got so many blessings from God. But those who have come late, to them also Baba says, though you are late, but still you are not too late. The too late board hasn't been put up yet. When will the too late board be put up? When we will be time for all of us to return home. And Shiv Baba and Brahma Baba will also return home. The study will finish. Then it will be too late. You know, too late board is put up means finished. All closed. House full. You go to a theater to watch a movie or anything and tickets are available and then it's put up, house full. So house full means too late. Now no more tickets available. There are no more reservations possible because the train is full, all seats are occupied. At this time the seats are not occupied. Baba says it's like you are in a musical chair game. In this musical chair game, no seats are occupied yet. Just two seats, Baba and Mama, only their seats are occupied first. Lakshmi and Narayan, those seats are fixed. First Lakshmi and Narayan. All other Lakshmi and Narayans which will be in golden age, their seats are not fixed yet. Nobody knows who will be them. Even you can become them. And therefore Baba says all the chairs are vacant, like in a musical chair game. Everyone is going round and round the chairs. Nobody has got the seat yet because the music is still on. And once the music stops, well, each one will get the chair. And if you are away from the chair, finished. You won't get it. So the attention is always towards the chair. You know, when people are playing musical chairs, the attention is towards the chair. The eyes are towards the chair and the ears are towards the music. That's how they play. And immediately as they hear the music stopping, they get the first chair which is in front of them. They can't go back, but they have to go in the front. So we have to always move in the front. Today should be better than yesterday. Yesterday should have been better than day before yesterday. Tomorrow should be better than today and so on. So this is why Baba says you have to keep the chart. And therefore, I am that blessed child of God. Every murli you take up, in it there are so many blessings. You can keep noting, this is the blessing of God, this is Baba's blessing, this is Baba's blessing. And every time you listen to the murli, the thought should be, Baba is giving me the blessing directly. This is the best way to feel the blessing. Don't think at that moment, oh, Baba is talking in general to thousands of people. No. At that time the thought should be, Baba is blessing me directly. I am the only one sitting in front of Baba and Baba is blessing me directly. Not just talking to me, because Baba's each version is not just a talk, but it's a blessing. Even in a question there's a blessing. When Baba says, do you consider yourself to be a master, almighty, authority, soul? It's not just a question, but there's a blessing merged in it, that I am that, but it should emerge from me, that I am that, with that courage and with that determination and faith. I should say it myself, that yes, I am. If Baba tells me and I don't accept, then I'll be burdened. God is telling me something, I'm not accepting it. Then what will happen? Just imagine. So therefore Baba doesn't maybe tell me straight away, he will question me first. And he does expect me to say yes, because it's a blessing. But in an indirect way, because Baba tells me, if he tells me directly and I'm not ready to accept, then I'll be burdened. And therefore questions me, therefore I should get the strength from inside, from me, to say, yes Baba, I am, and I can become that. Even if I may not be at this minute, but that moment the strength comes because Baba has blessed me with it. So this is how we claim Bhaktada's blessings. So through the drishti also we can claim blessing, not just through words. So when Baba gives drishti to me, at that moment the thought should come that God is looking at me. And how does the soul meet the Supreme Soul? Through the drishti. Gulzar Dadi is only a medium, but then at that time it's not Gulzar Dadi giving drishti. Baba takes the support of her eyes, her lips, her ears, her hands. And sometimes the feet, the legs. Otherwise, just eyes, ears, because Baba asks and children answer, so Baba listens. And then Baba speaks, so the mouth and the hands Baba gives slowly. Otherwise, the whole rest of the body is Gulzar Dadi's. It's not Baba's. Actually, Baba only takes it on loan. So at that very moment, the feeling should be that how am I, the soul, going to meet the Supreme Soul? These eyes are the windows. Gulzar Dadi's eyes were actually blessed by Baba. You know, Brahma Baba used to tell Gulzar Dadi that your eyes will do a lot of service. Baba used to tell her. So we are seeing that how through Gulzar Dadi's eyes, Bap Dada speaks. And Bap Dada sees the children and gives drishti. So when Baba comes on the 31st, Baba will give a long drishti to the children. And wherever you may be, don't think that, oh, I don't know whether Baba's drishti is falling on me or not. Baba's drishti goes around the whole world. Why not to you who may be in right in the corner? I remember once in Om Shanti Bhavan, one sister was sitting right at the end, you know, the last door. She was sitting just next to that door, the last seat. And Baba was giving drishti in the middle of the murli. It was a very powerful drishti to all. And after giving the drishti, you know, during the drishti, that sister was sitting right at the end, a thought was coming in her mind at that very moment. This hall is so big and Baba's drishti is moving around the whole hall. I wonder if Baba will be looking at me, you know. She was thinking like that. And she was just thinking at that very moment Baba spoke. Baba said, Baba is giving drishti even to that soul sitting right at the end. And that very moment the soul was having that thought. Can you imagine? So she came and told me later that really it's a wonderful thing. I'm thinking and here Baba is telling me that Baba is giving drishti to that soul too. Baba's drishti goes down the whole world. How long does it take for Baba to give drishti to the whole world? Baba sometimes says, I not only see you who are sitting in the corporeal form, but Baba is seeing the children sitting in all the centers around the world. You hear that, don't you? You listen to Baba through internet, don't you, all of you? Those who haven't yet listened to Baba on internet, please raise your hand, anybody? Who haven't listened to Baba on internet? Who have not listened? Acha? You have or not? Those who haven't, those who have not yet ever heard Baba on internet, in your centers. Acha? Okay, only a few. And those who have heard, raise your hand. Yes. So when Baba says, Baba is looking at all his children who are all over the world, when Baba can see his children all over the world sitting in one place, can't he give drishti to you sitting in the hall? You sitting in the hall? But then it depends on how much we are able to receive, as Mohini Ben was saying yesterday. The ocean is so full. I don't have to ask the ocean, can I fill a bucket from you? I don't have to ask. I don't even have to request that I need some water from you. You can fill, it's open for you. So God is there to give all His powers to you through the drishti. But how do I receive it? Through that consciousness, I am that. So whatever Baba expects me, I am that. Or if I say, oh, Baba has too many expectations, I can't be that. Then I'm like having my intellect which has holes in it, and the strength which Baba is giving to me will be drained away. So on the 31st, when you listen to Baba's murli or you are taking drishti at that time, have the thought, whatever blessings we have already received, think of those blessings. And keep filling the sack of your intellect with all those blessings. And at the end of the murli, you will realize how many blessings you have received. So not just through drishti, not just through the toli, but also through Baba's words, which will be in the form of blessings to the children. and feel that I am a blessed soul. Never have any other thoughts. You know, we create our own negativity and we spoil ourselves. So if we have those powerful thoughts, then automatically we will turn into blessed souls. Because we are blessed souls, otherwise we wouldn't be here. In yesterday's or this morning's blessing, Baba said, you wouldn't come to Baba otherwise if you wouldn't have any virtue in you. So each one has a virtue, and I have to see not only each one's virtue, but then I have to see that that virtue has been given to that soul by God. Or if I have that virtue, it has been given to me by God. So all those who come to Baba, who have recognized God, they are virtuous souls. So if we are virtuous souls, we are also blessed souls. And if we are blessed souls, we are fortunate souls. And therefore we should never have any other thought that I'm not blessed, that I'm not fortunate, I have no virtues. Never have such thoughts. Otherwise you wouldn't be here. Only the fortunate ones, the blessed ones, the virtuous ones will be here. Otherwise they won't be able to sit in the audience. So we are those blessed children, the fortunate children and the virtuous children who have come to meet God in the physical form, which no one in the world can ever imagine, that God comes to meet His children in this world. But then, as Baba is bodiless, He makes us into bodiless too. And therefore, when we are listening to Baba, we should have that consciousness that I am free from the pull of the physical body. Of course, the ears are with the body, but the consciousness should be that I am detached. Only in that bodiless, spiritual, plain state of intellect will I be able to grasp or take in whatever is Baba is telling to me. If I have questions, then too I will not be able to take in completely. So no questions, no doubts, no fear, no other complexities, just faith in self, faith in Baba, with that love, determination, and of course with the feelings that I am a blessed, virtuous and powerful soul, fortunate soul. So with that consciousness we will receive Baba's blessings on the 31st. Okay? Okay? Om Shanti, Om Shanti. Now a few minutes of silence.